welcome to TechTunnel.com's interview series. My name is Danny White, and today we have the opportunity to talk to Eric Van Hoven. Eric is the founder of the Academy to Innovate HR, the world's largest online community for people analytics professionals. He writes and speaks about people analytics and is an advocate of data-driven human resource management. He holds a master's in psychology, business administration, and a bachelor's in law. Welcome, Eric. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Danny. Nice to be here.
Awesome. So how have you seen HR professionals and executives' approach and attitudes change to the workplace and workforce analytics over the past couple of years?
Oh, that's a good question. We started this company, or Analytics in HR, we started 3 years ago. So I've been very active in the field in the last 3 years. And well, before that, I did some other stuff and I studied mostly. So I wasn't that much in touch with the field itself. But in the, mm-hmm. in the last 3 years, it has changed quite tremendously. Where when we started to write about analytics, the question was mostly HR managers were wondering, you know, what is analytics? How do I talk to the business about analytics? How can I build a business case for analytics? Mm-hmm. What are the tools that I need to use in order to do analytics? So very, very basic questions that basically came from, you know, I've heard from it and I think it's very exciting, but I don't really know what it is. So if I look at the questions that get asked now, they're much more in-depth, they're much more content-driven. The questions are, okay, how do I solve a problem A, B, or C? Using tool and then a specification. It's gone from very much, you know, what is analytics to, okay, how do I get started tomorrow? How do I do it in a practical way? And how do I move from, you know, just reporting HR data to making predictions and to really adding value? So the type of questions that we get asked have really, really changed. And with that, also the maturity in the market has really changed. That people are convinced now that analytics, you know, has some value, mm-hmm. and they're now asking, okay, how do I get that value? How do I convince the business? Where previously it was more like, what is analytics actually?
Absolutely, yeah. So you talk about how the conversation has changed and the questions has changed over the past couple of years. What do you think the current and future landscape of the workforce in general look like with new technologies in the picture, like artificial intelligence? What do you think it looks like over the next couple of years? What kind of questions will professionals who work with data ask when they have these new technologies to work?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, and especially if you talk about AI, I think that the first part of the question is, what does it look like today when we specifically talk about AI, and that, you mm-hmm. know, how will it look in a few years? Mm-hmm. The interesting thing about AI, if you really look at our HR organizations, human resource professionals. Are they now using AI actively to, you know, to make better recruitment decisions, to make better talent management decisions, to find out, you know, who should take course A compared to course B, because course A will have a better return than course B when it comes to sales, for example, in an individual shop. Those kinds of applications are very, very advanced for most organizations. I think if you look at the statistical data, it's about 5 to 7% that is actually reporting, self-reporting that they are using artificial intelligence in HR.
Mm-hmm. Now, so one quick question, why do you think the percentage is so low, only 5 to 7%?
Well, that's I think it has to do with it has to do that a lot of organizations, when it comes to HR data, a lot of organizations are still struggling with fairly basic questions. Mm-hmm. So If I run into an HR director of a large international organization, I'm never surprised when they tell me, hey, I don't know what my headcount is. I don't know how many people I have on the payroll. Mm. And that sounds like a very silly question when you have a small company or when you have 50 people on payroll. But if you're located in multiple countries, you have multiple systems, different systems that are not are compatible, but not always very compatible. The definition of your FTE of how you define headcount will differ from how finance is doing it, and also internally between the different system in the different countries. You know, you have different definitions, and one person who's working in department A for 20 hours a week and in department B for 20 hours a week might be counted double. So basic questions like what is my headcount are already quite hard to answer for these companies. So if you then talk about, hey, are we leveraging AI? You know, are we using our current data and then making active predictions using artificial intelligence and machine learning machine learning algorithms and other techniques, how you would define an artificial intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of organizations, they're not there yet. They're first struggling. Hey, let's get our data. You know, Inject has created data pool or data warehouse where we have all the data aggregated. And, you know, once that's in place, then we have a fairly structured data hole, data entity, a data structure where we can use in a structured way to do to run machine learning on it or to really leverage artificial intelligence. And you know, if you talk about artificial intelligence in HR, a lot of the applications are sold by vendors, and those vendors are saying, "Oh, I have a fantastic tool, and we're using artificial intelligence." And oftentimes, it's a fairly simple rule based thing that they apply to their software, and it's, you know, artificial intelligence is often used as a kind of a hype term to sell a product and make it very, very fancy. I think in a few years, you know, AI will make a tremendous impact. But till now, a lot of people are talking about it. But if you really look at the data, not that many people are doing it yet.
Mm-hmm. So back to the people analytics space, what are some of the technological advancements or milestones that have happened over the past few years that maybe some people who are new to people analytics might not know about?
Yeah, what I already said a few years ago, the questions were really about, you know, what is people analytics and how do I get started? And I you know, if through the blog we reach hundreds of thousands of people every single month.
Mm-hmm.
How do I put this right? You see that the type of problems that companies are dealing with have changed tremendously in the last three years. So back in the day, it was about, hey, how do I structure my all those different systems that I have in the different countries? How do I structure it? And how do I then create a data pool where all my data or a big part of my data, my most relevant data is, you know, in one place where I can then, you know, get a dashboard and get insight in the data, or maybe even do a prediction and you know, find out to turnover analytics, which is fairly popular in HR, where you can potentially predict what the likelihood is of someone leaving the organization within now and the next 6 months. Now, a few years ago, there were a few published cases where, for example, the Wall Street Journal wrote about a large organization that was doing it, and that was considered groundbreaking. Now, a lot of people in these organizations, especially in the larger organizations in the world, the top 1,000 organizations in terms of size, they are, you know, that they do those kinds of analyses, and it's not necessarily seen as something that, you know, that only the Google is doing and one of the other organizations are doing. It's now becoming more and more commonplace, and now organizations are more and more experimenting with things like sentiment analysis. You know, can we, with all the qualitative data that we have in HR, for example, our performance reviews, can we use a sentiment analysis to see, for example, open input data on questionnaires? You know, we can analyze 10,000 people and their open responses, and we can categorize it, and we can see a number of themes that are in those open responses without, you know, manually having to go through 10,000. Which is a bit of a hassle, as you might understand. you know, as an individual, you're looking at it and you're looking for something often. So you're biased in how you look at data. With a sentiment analysis, you can fairly easily see the sentiment and the different topics that people are talking about. So it's fairly easy to then analyze data. So the questions have gone from very basic to slightly more advanced and more interest in things like natural language processing, sentiment analysis, organizational network analysis, where a lot of organizations are now starting to invest in how can I look at the different networks in my organization? How is communication going? How is information going through the organization? How are people collaborating? Mm-hmm. Those are now topics that are more and more getting more and more interested, in the people analytics sphere. So the topics have become more advanced.
Absolutely. What would be some of your top tips or top pieces of advice specifically to CHROs, HR professionals, and executives who really want to build a data-driven decision-making environment in their organization?
That's another good question. My number one piece of advice is always just do it. Just get started. It can be very simple. sometimes you need, you know, you don't need all the information to make the best choice. Sometimes you just need a little bit of information to make the approximately right choice. You know, it's very hard to make the exact right choice because your data always has a certain bias in it. And, mm-hmm. and based on data, you'll never, you know, a 100% objective decision based on HR data will never happen because there's always a bias in the data.
Always a bias, yeah.
But there, you know, just having a little bit of data and just playing around with the data and trying to make a better decision, I think that is already very, very valuable. Mm-hmm. And you know, when it comes to becoming more data driven in HR, what would the first step be? Look at the data, look at what you have, and look at the business issues that are, you know, that are crucial to your organization at this point, and start to leverage some of that data to get some information on some of these critical business issues. And don't try to use all HR data for all issues that you have in the organization. Look at those critical issues where you say, hey, here is really something we're running into where HR can, you know, if HR would be able to help, it would be very valuable.
Right.
And HR does play a big role in this because, you know, there are certain people processes that help us expand our, you know, if you want to start a factory somewhere in a location in China, mm-hmm. you know, then you probably have a people challenge because there need to be, you know, that there are people that need to work in the factory. If you then have a turnover of 60-70% for your factory workers, you know, you potentially have a big problem when it comes to continuity. So that's a business problem where HR plays a significant role because mm-hmm. it's about people. It's about people leaving the organization or leaving that specific factory. Mm-hmm. And you need to find the relevant people also to put into that factory in the first place. If you don't have the relevant labor in that area, work for you, if you don't have that workforce, then you're never going to fill the factory. So that's a crucial business issue where HR can play a role. Mm-hmm. And there's most likely data available to solve that issue. And if you can then on that issue, you know, make a pilot project and fix it with data, make sure that people make a better business decision than as HR, you've come a long end already in becoming more data driven on that specific issue, mm-hmm. and you'll likely make a better decision in the end, a better business decision as well.
Do you think there are use cases of where people analytics has been applied within an organization or within an HR department that HR executives can look at as maybe a reference point as to how they can build their own practice?
Yeah, that's a good question. And the first example that comes to mind is what I already mentioned, turnover analytics. Mm-hmm. The Wall Street Journal published about Credit Suisse, which is a big international bank. Mm-hmm. And they were able to reduce turnover and save annually between, from the top of my head, 75 and 100 million US dollars annually. Wow. Just smarter with predicting and then preventing people to quit their jobs, mm-hmm. and preventing in the sense that, you know, if you can create a win-win between what the business wants and what the employee wants, you know, then that is really a win-win, and the money that you save, you know, there's a benefit to the employee and a bit benefit to the organization, because the employee is in the role that he likes or she likes. And the organization, you know, saves money, and that's usually something that the shareholders quite mm-hmm. quite appreciate and like.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's a fairly a simple example. There's also other examples. I don't remember the exact name of the company, but mm-hmm. someone who did an analysis, and of the 20 or 30,000 people that were working in that specific organization, they found out that a large majority of the revenue generating activities mm-hmm. was created by, I think it was 200 roles, critical roles in the organization.
Oh, wow.
Organization in the process of upskilling their workforce. So, you know, the organization is changing, like a lot mm-hmm. of organizations are now. And then they're looking, hey, where do we invest our, you know, if we talk about developing and making skills, creating and developing contemporary skills, where do we do that?
Right.
They found that 200 of those roles were very critical to the future of the organization, brought mm-hmm. in, I think, 70 to 80% of revenue, and then they decided to first upskill those roles before rolling it out in the rest of the organization.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very, also a fairly simple example. It really shows the power of looking at your data and
right.
making those better decisions based on data, with things that, you know, without data you had no clue, and you would just roll it out and start with department A and end with department mm-hmm. Z. Now you just do it in a way smarter way that in the end makes more business impact. So you know, HR has more and more of that strategic role that it has been talking about for such a long time.
Long time, yes. So talking about business impact, it seems in most companies, the HR department and the marketing department, they're the last to get the budgets. So what do you think your advice would be to HR executives and professionals who want to build a case for investing in people analytics or data-driven HR solutions, but they need to find an angle to prove it to senior management so they can get, you know, the support and the resources that they need?
Yeah, that's also a good question. Usually, especially when you talk about senior management, you have the proverb, and I won't say it completely, but there's data talks and something else walks. I can say that here on the. I think the original saying is money talks.
Money talks. Yeah, yeah.
And in this case, well, money. I translated it sneakily to the data. You know, money in the end, it's a hard. You know, a fairly hard criteria that you can specify fairly.
Absolutely.
But in when you talk about senior management, they are usually convinced. I still have to. They are usually convinced that a data-driven approach is a better approach.
It's a better approach, right?
And what one of the things that HR has traditionally run into is that they're very fairly much more talking about gut feeling than about the hard numbers. Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily talking about an ROI. Everyone wants to talk about a return on investment, which is very, very beautiful. But you know, it's sometimes quite hard to define an ROI on your HR activities.
Absolutely.
And you know, it is something you can try to specify, and if you're able to do that, that's very, very nice. Mm-hmm. But still, it's fairly hard to do. But if you can make the case that you want to be more data driven and make decisions based on data, mm-hmm. and that you can spend your budget on doing things like that,
right.
It's usually fairly easy to get approval. What I'm seeing a lot in practice is that a lot of HR directors and people analytics directors are getting a directive from the board that mm-hmm. says, "Hey, HR needs to be more data driven," and you know, guys, just do it. But make sure that HR is more data driven. So whenever it comes to convincing the board of, you know, doing HR analytics, what you're also seeing is the other way around, that the board mm-hmm. is saying, okay, you know, it's time to become really more data driven. Marketing is generally fairly data driven. It's hard to contribute, you know, a part of your sales, but we know mm-hmm. When we put $100 in Facebook marketing, that a number of people are clicking and that a number of people are purchasing.
Right, right.
And then there's a big discussion about, you know, how do you then attribute where the sale is coming from? Is it coming from Facebook or from an associated platform? Yeah. You know, but then you're already talking about, you know, how do you interpret the data? Mm-hmm. With HR, it's very much still the discussion of, hey, do we actually have the data, and is it mm-hmm. actually accurate data?
Yeah, can we use it?
There's definitely a need, and you know, when it's about convincing, I think it's the other way around, just as much as that HR needs to convince senior management.
Absolutely, Eric. Thank you so much for joining us all the way from the Netherlands.
Absolutely.
Awesome. Where can people find out more about you and your work?
We started 3 years ago. We're the largest people analytics platform worldwide. Mm-hmm. If you want to find more information, analyticsinhr.com is the blog where we have all the free content. If you really want to dive in and learn more with subject matter experts as instructors, go to hranalyticsacademy.com. That's a learning platform where we offer the courses where you can about the implementation of analytics, where you learn how to get started tomorrow and can start learning and doing analytics yourself in your organization.
Very cool. Thanks so much for the discussion and for sharing your insights with our audience. Guys, thanks for listening to this interview. For these and other interviews and topics, please visit techfunnel.com. You can connect with us across social, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Instagram, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter where you can stay up to date on everything that's happening in the industry. Thank you.